if I still, to this day, I go around the world and sometimes people will just say, what's your opinion on this or something? And I just kind of look, it's almost like delightful when they go, what is your opinion? Like, oh, like I don't really have one. But the question occasionally comes in every once in a while because it's just like a habit. People are used to like habitually asking, what's your opinion? What's your opinion? As if, you know, that's, I see it more as just a conversational starter now. People really, there's a curiosity and an openness underneath. That was one of those clips.
Sorry.
Go ahead.
Is it that we're, I'm not getting that we're supposed to now drop our opinions. Is that the goal to, when I have an opinion, catch myself and let it, and not do it, not have it? Or does it just come naturally from seeing the world?
Well, the dream will continue to play out, and you might say opinions come from, you know, beliefs and from thoughts, and so until the mind is cleared of those beliefs, there will still be opinions and judgments that will flash through and so forth. So one of the first stages we work with is called attentiveness or mind training, where you're doing a lot of mind watching. And sometimes it just comes out. I mean, that's part of the mind watching too. You know, it's not like you try not to speak an opinion or you try to control the behavior, you know, because sometimes it will just come, but it's more, it's a loosening, more of a sense of observing and watching. That's one big phase of the mind training, you know, where instead of just having those reactions just coming without any pause, then you have sometimes the pause goes a little bit greater and you're just more aware of like watching the thoughts as if there's someone back there observing the whole thing, which is very
nice. We're like looking at the source, we're just like, why do I have that opinion? Looking at where the ego is in it, that's what I think. So why did I feel such a need to have an attachment to my opinions? Because they were, and why do you speak it in past tense, my identity. And I had loosened a lot of it over the past couple of years, just allowing. Because the person I was 20 years ago, you had a different opinion than me, we weren't going to be friends. That's the way I was raised. There was no allowing, it was just separateness and dismissal.
Yeah, there's a part pretty late in the Course in Miracles where Jesus starts to talk about two aspects of the self-concept, which I think are important. We can bring them up now. One is, he calls the dream that you dream in secret, and one he calls the dream that you gave away. So the world as we perceive it, where there's people and they have seemingly minds of their own, and there's a world out there, and there's, you know, weather patterns and societies and governments and countries, and basically it is like a movie or like a play that's going on. That's the dream that you gave away, as if it's got its own causes and effects, you know, its own actions and reactions, as if it's apart from you. You know, people have that feeling like, okay, I'm a human being, I'm an individual, but there's this vast world, there's a cosmos going on outside of me, and there's a big complicated world out there, and it's huge, and it really doesn't have anything completely to do with me. I mean, it's as if the human being is a separate entity, and for years they've done movies and theater plays and novels about the individual versus society, or the individual versus the world. Because it basically, you know, sometimes this world can seem to be a pretty nice, cozy place, but in many cases it's pretty hostile. You know, it's a pretty hostile world out there. And this is what Jesus is calling the dream that you gave away. As if, like, you don't have any connection to it. Like, it's just happening to you. You know, sometimes you have a bad day, you have people that you've never met before, they come up, they treat you in nasty ways, they mistreat you. It's the dream that you gave away. It's like you're not pulling the strings, it doesn't seem like, on this world. It doesn't seem like you have complete control over the world, or in many cases, much control at all. It's like, well, this is the environment that I live in, and I just have to make the best of it, and if it gets too nasty, I'll move to another place and try to find other people or another environment that's not so nasty. So underneath that is what Jesus calls the dream that you dream in secret. And this is like this, this is the unconscious dream of its, to use his words, it's black. It's like draped with sin. It's dark. It's like what Carl Jung called the shadow underneath. And this is a dream of deep, deep unworthiness. The dream that I am not worthy of love, that I've done something terribly wrong somewhere, somehow, and it's really dark and really black. And you might say that in order to free your mind of the prison of this world or the prison of the ego, you have to release both aspects of the self-concept. The top tier, we'll call it, there's one tier that's above and one tier that's below. The top tier Jesus calls the face of innocence, which is kind of like, I'm a decent person. I mean, I have my good days and I have my bad days, but there are some days when things are done against me that are just not fair. It's just not fair. You know, I'm mistreated, abused in certain ways by the environment or by the people, by the governments, by something that's part of the top tier. The face of innocence is, he says, wet with tears many times at the injustices of the world. As if there's a big, vast world out there, and often it's hostile, and often there's mistreatment and abuse that goes on. Now that's just like the surface of the self-concept. That's like the mask. If you were wearing a mask, that's more like the mask to cover over the shadow. And basically, in order for the top tier to get happy, you have to really go down deep into that feeling of unworthiness, into that blackness and darkness, and really go through that and be shown, have that reinterpreted and shown that that's not really real, that those are just a bunch of false concepts, false beliefs that make that up. So that's going to be our journey today, is to start to come off of the surface and get past the dream that was given away and get down closer more and more to the shadow. We have a lot of good movie clips, a lot of opportunities to go inward today.
He's saying, oh yeah, and part of me is going, oh.
There it is. All on one couch. Oh yeah, oh crap. The yin and the yang. Hello there,
hi.
Tiffany. Hi. Come on in. So, it's good to know that you can't really solve the puzzle by working with just the top tier alone. I mean, I think that's where it gets frustrating for people when you try to make the world a better place, carve out your niche and make peace with the world, you know, reconcile yourself to the world. There really is no reconciliation on the top tier. It's almost like just the layer is describing the self-concept as two tiers, the top tier, the dream that you gave away, and then the lower tier, the dream that you dream in secret. And the reason that the lower tier is called like the dream that you dream in secret is it's so black that it's pushed out of awareness. It's literally the unconscious. It's like too dark to keep in awareness. And you know, it has a lot of memories. You know, you hear stories of people that seem to have gone through like real intense abuse scenes in their lives, whether it's being raped as a child or some kind of horrific kind of memory that gets pushed out of awareness. Like it's too dark to remember, so that sometimes later in their life there'll be a circumstance or an event that will trigger something. It'll be a memory that they had pushed completely out of awareness. You could say the same thing could be said about the ego. The ego is such a dark thought. The belief that you can separate from your Creator, it's such a dark thought that it's pushed way out of awareness. It's pushed way, way out of awareness. So, you know, when people wake up in the morning and their alarm goes off or their eyes open, they're not thinking, oh my God, another day of separation from God. You know, it's more just based on things like worries, concerns, survival issues. You know, that's what's going on the surface of consciousness. But underneath it, there's this horrific idea of belief in separation that's pushed way out of awareness, so it's not dealt with. It's just, that's the ego's way of dealing with intense pain and suffering. It's just pushing it out of awareness. Amnesia. Well, I'll forget about it. Conveniently. Push, push, push. And so that's why the spiritual journey often, we could say, is giving yourself permission and allowing this darkness to come to the surface where you can expose it and you can let it go. And release it instead of keeping it pushed down. So, if we go back to the mind training system that Jesus gave us in A Course in Miracles, you know, he starts off with his lessons. He goes between perception and then thoughts, because he's trying to make the connection between the thoughts that you think you think and the images that you think you see. Because the images that you think you see seem to be external. You know, they're part of the dream that was given away. And the thoughts are not always connected. You know, people aren't watching the news and a war breaks out and go, oh my God, what are my thoughts up to now? There's a war over in the Persian Gulf. What have I done? You know, it's like, oh, the dream that was given away, there's a war going on over there. It's on the news. Did you hear about it? So on and so forth. So the early workbook lessons of the Course are saying, like, nothing I see means anything, nothing I perceive means anything. And then he starts off with, in lesson 4, it says, these thoughts do not mean anything. Then he goes back to more perception lessons, and then around lesson 10, he's got, my thoughts do not mean anything. So he's talking about the thoughts that occupy everyday consciousness, are part of a data stream that's generating an environment, but they seem to be just the chitter-chatter, the static, the noise that's in the mind. You know, those everyday common thoughts. I kind of call them the top 40. What's in the top 40 today? Sometimes, like Casey Kasem, moving into the number 5 spot today is my mortgage payment. <You know? laughs> Because it's almost due date, and it will go to the number 1 spot. If I don't have any money by the day that it's due. You know, there's certain thoughts that seem to disturb you, and they're concern thoughts, and yet they kind of fluctuate in awareness. But it's like a data stream of basically past thoughts and future thoughts that are fearful or worrisome to some extent. And Jesus works his way through to some workbook lessons, 13 and 14, a meaningless world engenders fear. So he's working his way to a new connection between what seems to be the external world and the thoughts that you think you think. Because it seems like they're different. It seems like, well, there's a lot of whirling, crazy little thoughts going around in this little mind of mine, but it seems like they're disconnected to the world. They don't have any direct connection to the world. But he's teaching us a meaningless world engenders fear because I think I'm in competition with God. Now he's making a direct connection between the world that you think you see, the fearful emotion that's generated, and the idea that I think I'm in competition with God. And he says, you may not believe this idea, you may dismiss this idea completely. He's making a cause-effect connection between these attack thoughts, we'll call them, these false identity thoughts, these thoughts that I can make myself and create myself any way that I want to be. I can do makeover. I can create myself to be male, female, fat, skinny, tall, short, you know, Caucasian, African, know, all the different thoughts that seem to be part of the made-up identity, underneath all of these thoughts, you know, of I can choose to make myself any way I want to be, is an authority problem going on with God. God created us as spirit. So any thoughts that we're having, and any beliefs that we hold that are in opposition to our eternal creation as spirit are part of an authority problem. Not an authority problem with the cops, or with lawyers, or with teachers, or with, judges, or military personnel, or on and on and on. All those seeming authority problems and issues that the personality seems to have with people in the environment, or with governments, or with society, or whatever, those are all just part of the smokescreen. If you work it way back into the mind, you start to see that there's an authority problem going on, and this authority problem, this issue, is with God. And of course, the real God is just pure love, so the real God is just knows perfection, knows spirit as spirit. There's no authority issue going on in the mind of God. All is perfect in heaven. But for the mind that has fallen asleep and forgotten God, and forgotten love, and forgotten heaven, then this is the issue that's going on. It's just getting projected to the world. So really the issue is, underneath it all, can I create myself as I want to be, or was I already created by God? Can I make myself in my own likeness and image, or was I created in the likeness and image of God, or was I created like God as spirit? So that's the issue that's going down on way down in the mind. That's where the struggle really is. And it just doesn't seem to be that way in everyday life, because this struggle is pushed way out of awareness. It's just pushed way down. So it just plays out in terms of the dream world in many different frustrations and conflicts and issues. Another way of looking at the authority problem would be to say it really is a question of authorship. When you look at an authority issue, it's like, who is my author? Am I the author of me, or is the Creator the author of me? And this dream world and this egoic false perception, false identity, is a reflection of the belief that I can create myself. So even when you read, sometimes you read those New Age books, you pick up a New Age magazine and it says, big letters on the front, you can create your own reality. You go, oh, that sounds really empowering. It's not really. Because the creator of reality is where the power is, and accepting yourself just as you were created in creation, created by God, is the most humble and yet the most empowering and powerful experience there could ever be. And to kind of try to buck the system, or to deny God, or to try to usurp that creation and say, I can do better, I can make up a better self than you can make, that's where the issue comes in.